Martin Logan here, and welcome to the Irish in the UK, and what a great show from Henry McGlade from Ireland. Coming up on the show tonight, we're going to be finding out a little bit more about Food Share, who are a UK-based charity. Nathan Carter is back in Manchester at the Bridgewater Hall. But first up, back in 2015, a massive earthquake hit Nepal, almost killing 9,000 people and injuring 22,000. Well, the Cheshire Fire and Rescue Service are sending out a group of their apprentices to help with the reconstruction and build communities. And we went along to meet them before they leave.
Cheshire Fire Rescue Service back in 2016 launched a bespoke 21-month apprenticeship scheme, which was unique in this country, and it was about taking young people and giving opportunities to be operational firefighters. However, when we looked and we planned the programme, we didn't just want solely based around our operational side. We wanted to give them a blended approach, so basing our op stuff with our non-operational community safety agenda. It's about the guys and girls on the cohorts really understanding the modern fire rescue service and what we're doing out there in the communities to make people as safe as possible.
Of course, it's a very, very important job. We see it so many times. People are rescued by the fire services and so on. So is it a special type of person that you need to join?
I think it is a very unique role, isn't it? And it's ever changing. But our current apprenticeship cohort have really got a mix of people from the community, so diverse in ages and where they live as well. So.
Now, for the apprentices to apply, of course, for boys and girls, is there any special age that they need to be?
So our staff, when we opened our doors for applications, had to be 18 years old due to our insurance and the responsibility of the role, really, as well. So we've had people all from Scotland, all across Cheshire or wider afield as well. So
how long does it take to actually get people trained up before we actually see them on the street, let's say, fighting fires and rescuing people and generally helping out the community?
So on the scheme itself, the apprenticeship scheme, is 21 months. However, we embed a 16-week recruit course. So that's the 16 weeks of operational practical firefighter training. So what you'd expect to see if your house or your car was on fire. However, it's done modular, so they do it in sections and blending that with some of the work around the Nepal fundraising project or community safety-based activities.
So tell us about the hours now that you work. Obviously, I'm presuming that you work all sorts of hours because you're on duty 24 hours a day.
Yeah, so our fire service works 24/7. However, our apprentices follow a Monday to Friday work pattern, and we've embedded that with a little bit of shift work as well, just to prepare them for when they go onto station.
Great stuff. Now, of course, we're going to be chatting to some of your apprentices today because they are off to do some wonderful work in Nepal.
So our apprentices travel out in March 2018 to build a school in partnership with a local charity called Classroom in the Clouds. And when we designed our bespoke programme, we wanted to be as diverse as possible, so we looked at different opportunities that we could give them that would end up ensuring we had a better apprentice at the end of that. And one of the links we had was with the charity Classroom in the Clouds, and we decided that this fundraising challenge would be one for them they could take on and excel at.
Fundraising is very important for us to get to Nepal, as we've got to raise £30,000 as a team. So we've been doing various events around Cheshire. We've done car washes, we've done a charity ladder climb where we had to climb the height of Everest. We've done a charity stepping challenge again where we also had to climb the height of Everest, and that worked out with 3,000 flights of stairs that we had to climb in full fire kit and breathing apparatus. So.
My goodness, at least you'll be fit before you go to Nepal.
Yeah, exactly, very fair.
Now, I know that the Warrington Irish Club and Chris Whitehead and Frank O'Brien and all the team over there have been very supportive to you.
Yes, they have. They've helped me raise £200 altogether so far through a raffle, and they've got a couple of events planned for me soon. So we've got, on the 4th of February, there's a fundraising afternoon there, and on the 2nd of March, there's a charity race night there as well. So They've been very, very supportive.
Excellent. I hope loads of people support that for you. Now, Josh, you're away to Nepal as well. Now, tell me, what preparations are you making before you actually go out there?
Other than the fundraising, we've had a couple of days out walking just to prepare us fitness-wise. So we've spent some days out in Snowdonia and Wales. We've been to the Peak District, so we did our Duke of Edinburgh's as well. Just all just preparation to make sure that when we get out there that we can enjoy it as best as we can and we're not exhausted the whole time we're there.
Now, Holly, what are you expecting when you get there? Because we've all seen Nepal on the television. We know that they've gone through a really difficult time. So when you actually touch down in Nepal, what are you expecting to be like?
I don't think any of us really know what to expect when we get there, but we know it's going to be a big challenge. We've got 5.5 days of trekking ahead of us when we land in Nepal. We've got to carry all of our things with us, so it's going to be a big challenge, but I think we're all ready for it and we're excited to go.
Of course, Nepal is in a really bad state at the moment, and it's vitally important that people like you go out and help them and try and do the very, very best for them. But having said that, are you worried about going out, or are you looking forward to it?
I think we're all really looking forward to it. We've worked really hard to get into the position of raising £28,000, so it would be silly not to be excited.
Classrooms in the Clouds is a registered charity and we work in the remote areas of Nepal supporting education, building classrooms, and we sponsor teachers, Nepalese teachers. We also provide training for the teachers.
Now, how did you first get involved with Cheshire Fire and Rescue Services?
We were working with Cheshire Fire and Rescue through my husband, who is a former firefighter, and he just happened to be talking with the Deputy Chief Mark Cashin and saying that I was in Nepal doing some work out there. And Cheshire have got a really long history of working with the developing world supporting education, and we were really inspired by their enthusiasm and dedication to this work, and Mark and Mike decided that it would be a great partnership to work with Classrooms in the Clouds.
Now, 2015, of course, there was a massive earthquake in Nepal, killing a lot, 9,000 people, I believe, and injuring a lot more. Now, a great deal of work needs to be done out there to help them. Tell me a bit about what your aim is and how you're trying to help them.
Yes, we work very closely with remote rural communities, and of course education is key to improving and breaking down the barriers around poverty. A lot of the schools have been built a long time ago and many were damaged by the earthquake. In fact, the project that the Cheshire Apprentices are involved with, the early years classrooms were devastated by the earthquake. So that project is key to replacing those classrooms and in particular providing earthquake resistant buildings for the students. The important part of some of the work we do is around first aid training as well, because it came to the fore that many of the remote communities were actually unable to provide very simple first aid in the event of disasters such as the earthquake. So we are working very closely and we provide sustainable projects by visiting and revisiting and monitoring them very closely.
Now, how does Classroom in the Clouds raise money to try and help people that's in Nepal and other areas like this?
Of course, a charity is only a charity through the money that they raise. We cannot do the work that we do without the fundraising. We've got a strong partnership with Cheshire. We've already had two groups of cadets going out, and now we have this apprentice group going too. We have a number of higher value sponsors, including Rotary, Sir Optimist groups. We also have one or two corporate donors, and also the day-to-day donors, the long-term everyday supporters who've been absolutely wonderful and who've stuck with Classrooms in the Clouds over the 10 years that we've been involved in Nepal.
If some of our viewers tonight would like to subscribe or donate or do something to help you out, how can they do that?
If they want to log on to our website, citcnepal.com, cheshirefirerescue.org and click on the donate button. It couldn't be easier, and that would be wonderful. But looking at our website and looking at the work we do and spreading the word is equally valuable.
Last year, Danny Main came to me and James Keenan would we try and raise some money for the Nepal project and that for his niece.
Okay, and of course, since that, you've arranged a couple of events. Now, tell me about the events that you've arranged.
Well, we've got the launch of the gathering on the 4th of February, and it's at the King's Head at 1 o'clock. And we've got music all afternoon, and then in the evening, we're going to the Irish Club, which there'll be music on there at 6 o'clock. And they've done a lot of work over the years for the Irish Club as well.
Yeah, that's the Irish Club in Warrington, of course, and great supporters. And I believe that you've got a big gathering of people coming from Ireland.
Yeah, there's people coming from Ireland for a wedding from the Scanner County Clare, and they're also going to join us up in the events as well.
Oh, it sounds like a great fundraising event, Chris.
I don't know about that, but I'd say there'll be a few sore heads Monday morning.
A lot of great work has been done in Nepal to help all those people who have been affected. Now it's time for us to take a little short break. Welcome back to the Irish in the UK. Now, if you've got a story to tell us or if you'd like us to promote your business, contact me. The details are on the screen now. Now, Foodshare are a UK-based charity who fights hunger and food waste. They rescue good food which would be otherwise wasted and deliver it to people who are in need.
Fairshare was set up in Greater Manchester in partnership with Emerge back in 2008.
Okay, so tell me, what do you do here?
So we work in partnership with a national charity called Fairshare, and we run, essentially it's like a franchise operation. We run according to their policies and procedures. We take surplus in-date food from the food industry in big bulk quantities. We break it down and we split it into orders, and we redistribute the food to 230 organisations across Greater Manchester at the moment.
Now, this is a massive job, isn't it? We saw this morning your van's been loaded there. You've got so many people down there working on all this. This is like a continuous chain every day.
Yeah, so we've got food coming in all of the time from fresh produce, frozen, chilled and ambient, so like your pasta and your tea bags, that sort of thing. It's coming in from the food industry. It's surplus in-date food. We, as I say, we break it down into smaller quantities for orders. We allocate the food out to various organisations, charities, schools, breakfast clubs, after-school clubs, food banks and other organisations like community centres that do hot meals for people who are in need across the conurbation.
So how much food do you actually deal with and people you deal with during the year?
So in the last year, we've managed over 1,000 tonnes of food. That's in terms of equating it to meals, that worked out to be about 1.3 million meals. And we work with around about 20,000, through those organisations, our community food members, as we call them, we work with about 20,000 people a week. Year on year, we run the Fair Share operation. Emerge is a registered charity, and Fair Share is one of our activities. Unfortunately, we can't quite make it work to make ends meet in terms of the foods donated. We do make a small charge to our beneficiary organisations. They pay for the support of that food that we supply to them. But actually, the cost of the operation, the vans, the fuel, the overheads, the staffing, the depot costs, we have to raise funds to support some of that. So year on year, we're looking to get donations, whether that's from companies in terms of corporate social responsibility, whether that's from trust funds or individual donations. And we're very privileged to receive a range of support from a whole bunch of people in Greater Manchester and further afield. But we're always looking for new people to work with. We also have opportunities for corporate volunteers who might want to put their time in. So we're quite keen to work with companies to do a package of support where people can volunteer. We might be able to advertise their name on the van, for example. But we're keen to talk to people in those various ways. By all means, contact me directly or contact us through the website. We're also looking for food companies in Greater Manchester and the surrounds who might have surplus in-date food. So if anybody does, please do contact us at the Fair Share team via our website, emergemanchester.co.uk.
My name's Mark Game. I am a charity called the Bread and Butter Thing, and we are what's called the community food member, so we get food from Fair Share.
Okay, so where do you distribute the food to, or who do you supply?
So we supply a number of different areas that are challenged in Manchester. We offer the communities deeply discounted food so that they can afford to get by.
How important do you think this is, that you can offer discounted food to people, you know, that's struggling?
Well, we need to do more. So there are so many people around Manchester that are struggling. We're only touching the surface at the moment. We're talking to over 600 families. We're feeding them regularly, but there are hundreds of thousands of people in need around Manchester. So this is vital.
Well done to them all at Fair Share. Now Nathan Carter is here at the Bridgewater Hall in Manchester, and I'm off inside to see if I can find him. Nathan!
Martin, great to see you here with the Irish in the UK.
Well, thank you very much, Nathan. Of course, we've come along to see you here at the Bridgewater Hall tonight. Are you looking forward to performing here in Manchester again?
I can't wait. As you know, I started gigging when I was about 17 in the pubs and clubs, mainly in Manchester. I was here every other weekend. And never ever dreamt that it would get to this, where I was playing in a 2,000 capacity concert hall here in Manchester. So this is my first time here and can't wait for tonight's show. Really looking forward to it.
Well, it's going to be a great night here, of course, in Manchester. But looking back over 2017, it's been a great year for you.
It has, yeah. Between gigs, I did two of the biggest shows of my career so far. I played the Three Arena in Dublin, the SSE Arena in Belfast. They were both sold out. I did a second series of my TV show, which is for RTE. With special guests like Melanie C from the Spice Girls. We had everyone, Una Healy, Billy Ocean, you name it, they were on it. So it was really good fun.
As we said, you're here in Manchester tonight, but tomorrow night, of course, you're going back to your hometown in Liverpool.
Yeah, looking forward to tomorrow now. And I've got this 15 family coming from cousins and aunties and uncles. And of course, my nan and granddad are going to be there, and my mum and dad. So looking forward to tomorrow.
Now, I know you're really busy, but any plans going back into the recording studio?
Delighted to say I'm going back to Nashville next month. I'm going to be spending 4 days in Nashville sticking down some new tracks for a brand new album. I've written 4 or 5 tracks at the minute, and I've gone into the archives, as they said, and dug up a few old country songs that haven't been sang in a long time, so I'm going to stick my own version down of them, and hopefully I'll have an album out for this summer. That's the plan.
And Nathan, of course, you're a young man, and St. Valentine's Day is only around the corner. Are you bringing out anything special for then?
I am, yeah. I've written a ballad, a love song, and recorded it, and it's being released just a week before Valentine's Day, so hopefully people will download it. It's going to be on iTunes, and I've done a video for it as well, which I recorded in Kells in County Meath, in an old mansion house, an old boarding school. So looking forward to that coming out, and hopefully people will like the song and feel romantic when they listen to it.
Have you settled down now living in Ireland? You know, do you really miss England, or are you quite happy living in Ireland?
I love living in Ireland. I live in Fermanagh, not too far from Enniskillen, and myself and Jake, my brother, we share a house together, so although we're kind of like passing ships in the night, we never really see one another, but I love Fermanagh. I've got a boat, and I love the lake there, Loch Earn, so I'm always on that as much as I can. But I do miss Liverpool sometimes. I miss my family, really, mum and dad and my nan and granddad, although I get to see them sort of once a month, twice a month, and then nan comes on tour with us whenever we're over here, so I get to see a lot of nan most of the time. But I think probably Ireland's going to be home now for the foreseeable, that's for sure.
What a great night we've had here at the Bridgewater Hall in Manchester with Nathan Carter. And I've been joined by Nathan's nan and her very best friend, Carol.
Hello.
Girls, have you enjoyed the show?
Wonderful.
Absolutely.
Wonderful. Grace.
Yeah.
That's better every time he goes on.
Well, absolutely fantastic. And where are you tomorrow night?
Oh, Liverpool! The capital of Ireland.
Now, don't forget, Henry McGlade is back next Thursday evening with the Irish Tournament Abroad at 7 o'clock, and I'm here at 7:30 with the Irish in the UK. Both shows are repeated on Saturday night between 8 and 9 p.m. And we're going to leave you with who else but Nathan Carter.
Away from the old north wall, traveling feet gave me the call, leaving a suitcase in my hand. With the price of a pint, didn't need a bite. There was good old crack on the boat that night as we left our homes in Ireland. And the lights, they flickered from the shore, the boat was rocking to and fro, heading for the docks of Liverpool. How we sang the night away, the squeeze box and the fiddle played, stepping off the boat in Liverpool. Boy. Rise up at the crack of dawn, working hard the whole week long. Nighttime I'd play me old guitar. How we sang by side and standing tall, the crack was good down in the Liffey bar. The lights, they flickered from